Good morning.
Morning, Matt.
Very happy to be here this morning. Pulled in this morning very happy with a smile on my face and very excited to preach from the Word. So this morning we're going to be in 1 Peter chapter 1. So throughout the summer, actually more like May, June, I had heard of people memorizing books of the Bible. And I was like, wow, that's crazy. And then in May or June, I really felt led to start memorizing a book of the Bible. And so, this is me trying to sound super pious, I'm going somewhere with this. And as I thought about it, I thought, oh, maybe Philippians. Philippians is a solid book. But then God started doing that thing he does where there are these scriptures that just start really like cutting into my soul and really resonating with me. And they were all coming from 1 Peter. So I said, okay, 1 Peter it is. So it's been a journey of memorization and studying, and I'm thankful for it. And I would encourage you to do the same. It sounds daunting, but when you really break it down to like a verse a day or every other day, it's actually pretty manageable. And, you know, cut out things that don't actually matter, like TV and other things. What? But in reality, it's very doable. And so, and it draws us closer to God, and so I'm thankful for that. And so, 1 Peter is a dynamite book that is filled with Old Testament references and allusions and how Christ fulfills them. So we're going to get into 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 19. So Peter writes, "Therefore, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, 'You shall be holy, for I am holy.' And if you call on him as Father, who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile waste inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot." Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. God, may you richly bless this reading of it. And God, may you use it to plant a seed in our soul and our mind and our heart to help us live faithfully for you, to refine us and to grow us and draw us closer to you. God, you are good. And we thank you for everything you do. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So as previously stated, 1 Peter is a just dynamite book that is packed with details and goodness. And so therefore, I want to give a little background to 1 Peter itself, and then give a background to 1 Peter chapter 1, and then we'll dig into it. So the context of 1 Peter, it is a circular letter. So what that is a writer of the book of the Bible, they would write a letter and they would send it to a bunch of different churches. They would send it to this church and they would copy down manuscripts and copies, send that out, and it would go around in a circle. So 1 Peter is written to Pontus, to believers in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Not that that matters, but just a little fun fact for you. Actually, Galatia does matter because there's the book of Galatians, so they're getting a double dose of encouragement. But it's a circular letter that addresses the sufferings and persecution that many of the individuals in these contexts were facing. He's addressing suffering and persecution. And he addresses in this letter how persecution and suffering have the capability to discourage us, but also to refine us and draw us closer to God. The very things that we think are the things that would drive us away from God, God can actually use to draw us closer to himself. He uses that to strengthen us and refine our faith. So in chapter 1, Peter has talked about a lot so far. And so they really set up the rest of the book, verses 1 through 12. They set up the rest of the book, and it's like this lens that we can start viewing these things through. So verses 1 and 2, Peter addresses the purpose of the letter and how the Trinity, God Himself, is at work in us through this letter. So he talks about how God Himself, God the Father, foreknew the sufferings that these people were facing. He knew about it. He says, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. God knew and allowed and ordained the suffering of these people in their context and our suffering for our good and His glory. God allowed, ordained, and previously knew the sufferings that they would be facing. And that's meant to give them hope and encouragement. It's meant to, for us as well, when we face trials, whether sickness or if, you know, something with America or even going overseas, you know, like our brothers and sisters in other countries where they are physically persecuted, that gives us hope because God sees us, God knows that this is going on, and we know that He's doing good through it. Secondly, he prays that this letter would sanctify us or make us holy by the work of the Holy Spirit. So here we've got God the Father, God the Spirit, and then he says the third reason is to display and explain what obedience to Jesus Christ looks like. And that through this letter, people would come to salvation in Jesus. So we've got the Father, the Spirit, and the Son. The foreknowledge of God the Father, sanctification of the Spirit, and for obedience to Jesus Christ, and for sprinkling with His blood. So that's the first two verses. Verses 3 through 5, after that, Peter goes on to explain how our salvation through Jesus gives us hope for a future inheritance that has been given to us through the sacrifice of Jesus. In fact, Peter calls this hope a living hope because Jesus is alive. He calls it a living hope because Christ has been raised from the dead. He says it's a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, meaning that Christ is alive forever, evermore. In the same way that He died and rose again and is alive forever, that is what our hope rests in. Not by our own efforts, but by what Christ has done and how He is alive. And this inheritance is eternity with Him. So it gives us a hope for a future day. Verses 6 through 9, he addresses how our salvation gives us hope in the present. We face trials, we suffer, but God uses our suffering to refine our faith. He uses the infamous analogy of comparing faith with gold. How he says gold gets refined by fire. So what they do, when they heat up gold, they turn it into like this liquid or sludge, and they heat it up. They put fire underneath it. And when that happens, all of the stuff that isn't gold, all of the impurities rise to the surface so that the person that's refining the gold scrapes the impurities away. And he says, in the same way, our faith is like that gold, and the fire is the trials that we face in life and the sufferings. And so that heats our faith up, and God uses that trial, that suffering, to scrape out what is not of Him. He refines our faith through suffering. That's why suffering, though it doesn't feel good, why suffering can be a very good thing. God can use suffering for our good and His glory. And we see that throughout the Bible. We even go back to the book of Genesis, chapter 50. After Joseph reconnects with his family and his brothers are scared because they sold him into slavery, he said, "You meant this for evil, but God meant it for good." God can take unspeakable tragedy and bring about ultimate good. Thus, we have hope that God is still good in the midst of that circumstance and that He's still doing good in our lives. And thirdly, verses 10 through 12, he talks about how our salvation is anchored in the past. We see that God is faithful throughout the whole of the Old Testament and the New Testament. He is faithful to bring salvation to us, and therefore that gives us hope in the present. So it's anchored in the past, gives us hope in the present, and now we have hope in the future. future for a day when we will be with him forever. So that's verses 1 through 12. And that sets up all of this that we're going to talk about today in verses 13 through 19. So the first point I want to make is that hope is the fuel for holiness. Hope is the fuel for holiness. So our hope is ultimately created by our salvation in Christ. It's ultimately created by that. So in verse 13, Peter starts this new flow of thought. He uses the common yet dynamite word that we find in the Bible pretty frequently. It's therefore. He starts with therefore. If you're unfamiliar with the importance of the word therefore in the Bible, especially in the letters, so here's the rule of thumb. Whenever you see the word therefore, you should ask, what is it there for? Oh, Bible jokes. I like laughter. I'll be here all morning. So in other words, therefore, the word therefore usually begins a new flow of thought, implying that everything that the author was just talking about leading up until this point is like this giant crescendo, and it explodes in this point they're about to make now. So they're saying, in other words, everything I've been talking about culminates into this point. We find it in the book of Romans as well. After 7 full chapters packed with just theological goodness and practical goodness, Paul writes in Romans 8:1, he says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. He says, therefore. Whenever you see that word therefore, it's important. Let it stand out. And so Peter starts verse 13 with therefore. He's building up this idea, and he's building on it, that this living hope we have because of our salvation through Jesus Christ. So because of our salvation, here in verse 13, Peter calls or commands us to do something very interesting. He says, he commands us to set our hope fully on the grace that will be brought to us at the revelation of Jesus Christ. He says, set our hope on the grace that will be revealed when Christ returns. It's a hope that's ultimately in God. When we read that, that grace will be revealed, at least when I first read it, that grace is going to be revealed, it may cause us to ask, well, don't I already have grace? Isn't what Jesus did on the cross grace? And yes, absolutely. What Jesus did is grace. I have grace through Christ, that he offered up himself on the cross, cleansing me of my sin, taking away the punishment, interposing his precious blood, his sacrifice, his forgiveness into my life. Yes, absolutely, grace. So then what's this grace he's talking about here? He's telling us of a deeper picture of grace, a more complete grace. Because in this life, we sin. We have a sinful nature. We are in the thick of a war, and though we have been redeemed, we face an ever-present wrestling against the flesh, the sinful nature. Every day we face it. Judgmentalism, lust, anger, pride. I am so prideful. Jealousy. All of these things. We face these things on a daily basis. Every hour, every minute, every second, we face this ever-present and very genuine battle in our lives against the flesh. So then, what he's talking about is when Christ returns, our lowly bodies, where sin still rears its ugly head, will be transformed into glorious resurrected bodies. We will be with him in his presence unhindered, and we will see his face forever. We will be with him, present to present, person to person, face to face, child to creator, forever. That is the beauty of the complete picture of grace that is going to be revealed when Christ returns. Grace will have been fully realized in that moment, and every moment after his return, because there will no longer be any separation between us. Paul writes in Romans 8, verses 24 through 25. He says, for in this hope we were saved. Now, hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. So we wait for this day when this hope will be realized, like a kid that is eager for Disney World, or a couple that is eager for their wedding day. I was just at a wedding on Friday, and I realized again that I can't dance. So a couple that is so anxious for their wedding day, and that hope, in the same way, even more infinitely so, we have this hope that is in Jesus. And then whether we die first or Christ returns, in that moment we will be united with him, and hope will be fully realized. I don't need to hope for anything anymore, because I have what I've hoped for forever. Amen. And it's fully realized. It is the grace that is fully realized when Christ returns. That is the very thing we hope for, eternity with him. Just to give a brief tangent, because reality check. Some of you may be wrestling in the area of your faith. Whether you are doubting your salvation, or you are doubting if you may even last long enough to see that day, to see his face. We face very real doubts at times, at various seasons of life. And maybe you are afraid that your hope will dry up. And in those moments, when we feel like, I don't know if I can do this, we go back to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 5. I don't have it in the slides, but it's just a small verse. He says, he's talking about us, by God's power, are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. So again, salvation that is given to us by grace. It's by God's power that we are preserved through faith, not our own doing. It's never been on our own strength. In this verse that I just read, we are encouraged that if we are truly born again, it is not, nor has it ever been, our power that preserves and initiated our faith in the first place, but on the power of God alone. It is by his power that our faith is preserved and maintained, not our will and our effort. And so in those moments when we face those doubts, we cling to God and his power. So may we have a rock-solid confidence that God will preserve our faith by his might. So the first point is that hope is the fuel for holiness. And so, okay, we see this hope. It initiates this joy and this compulsion to live a holy life, and then reality hits. So the second point, the battle for holiness. Verses 13 through 14. Between this moment in time and the moment when Christ returns, we face battles on a daily basis of various degrees and in various elements. The first and most obvious battle that the Bible talks about is the battle of the heart. Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. He also said, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. Proverbs 4:23 says, guard your heart, for from it flows your entire life. Jeremiah says the heart is deceitful and desperately sick. Who can understand it? The heart is a big issue in the Bible. But Peter is writing that, or he's going on the assumption that majority or all of his readers are believers. So when we have faith in Christ, our heart of stone is turned into a heart of flesh. So he does address the heart at certain times, but that's not his focus now. He goes to the next big battlefield, the mind. In verse 13, he says, therefore, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded. The mind is a treacherous place where we linger on offenses, conjure evil thoughts, and let our doubts and fears fester. So much of the mind influences our actions and attitudes. The battlefield of the mind can be something that can eventually become a hope killer. We start having doubts. I see it in students all the time when at school we go on a retreat and all these students are just connected with Jesus, and then within a week it just feels like that hope's gone. Because the battlefield of the mind, they start second-guessing things. They start thinking about sin more than they're thinking about truth. And it's just this battle and this war going on inside of the mind. In Romans 12, Paul encourages believers to be transformed by the renewal of their minds. And transformation happens when the mind is renewed and we abstain from the pattern of the world. So in Peter's view, in this text, how do we do this? How do we do this? He admonishes us to prepare our minds for action and to be sober-minded. So what does this mean? So let's look at that first phrase, prepare our minds for action. So the literal Greek reading is gird up the loins of your mind, which is a phrase that is uncommon to us. So can you throw that next picture up? There's a picture in the slides. Oh, good. It's a step-by-step instruction of how to gird one's loins. Just in case you were wondering. So obviously, back in this time period, they wore tunics. And so if a man had to go to work in the field or even go to war, you're not really going to be able to function properly in your tunic. And so they would hike up their tunic, tuck it through their legs, wrap it around, and tie it, and then, like, go off to battle. And so, it's a weird illustration. But the picture is that as a person who's getting ready to go off to war, that is the same way that we approach the battle of the mind. As someone who is preparing themselves, he acknowledges that it is a fight to resist the evil thoughts of the mind. Therefore, we must go to war against our thoughts and our mind, these sinful thoughts. It is not a passive, cross your fingers type of activity, but it's all out war of the mind. Prepare yourself, what kind of what he's saying, he says, prepare yourself as if you're going to war. Prepare yourself as if you're going to battle. You don't train for war in the middle of a battle. You don't ever do that. It's not smart. You will die. But you go to boot camp, you practice in a place that is training you for the day that you go to battle. Likewise, the mind is most fit for battle when it has been trained in the quote-unquote off-season. When is the off-season? We don't really know. There's never a time when it's really an off-season, when we're not going to war against our mind. But that's, I think, part of the point. Therefore, we must take this preparation and this fighting as an everyday endeavor. Because in the moments when we do feel intimately close with God, as he grows us in our minds and he fills our mind and our heart with scripture, in the valleys of life and the times of suffering and persecution, our minds are fixed on Christ because we've prepared in the off season. It's not I'll get there when it happens. No, we never prepare for that. If I, as you can see, a scrawny human being, decided to try out for the NFL and just join the Eagles later today, even though they're facing the Broncos who haven't won a game yet, I would still get crushed. I am not fit enough. I am not strong enough. I am not strategic enough. I am not prepared. And that's the same type of deal when we face the trials in life. We need to prepare all the time so that when it hits, we're ready and we're seeking the Lord, albeit not perfectly, but relying on grace. So, on the one side of the coin, we have preparing our minds for action. On the other side of the coin, Peter says to be sober-minded. That's not rocket science, be sober, so not drunk or not overindulged on things that are sinful of the mind. He says, be sober-minded. Do not let your mind be encumbered with the thoughts of sin. So how do we go about these things? If the best defense is a good offense, Paul gives us a pretty good answer in Philippians chapter 4. He says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be made known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. So to kind of combine Peter's thought and Paul's thought that we just read, rejoice in the salvation of the Lord and set your hope on Jesus. When your sinful mind seeks to distract you from Jesus and the worries of sin in this life, pray to the Lord and seek Him, actively setting your mind on things that are good and true and honorable and pure and etc. The best two ways of doing this, fill your mind with Scripture and prayer. Those are the biggest two ways. It's not this mindless Buddhist meditation of emptying your mind. You fill it with the Word of God. I'm an avid coffee drinker, and in my classroom at school, I have this little coffee bar set up behind my desk. Sometimes I don't clean out my mugs every day, and so it doesn't exactly look pretty the next day. But if I did not clean out the mug and use the same mug every day, the bacteria would fester. So I need to cleanse it of the things that are impure and in order to fill it with the good. Preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded. So if hope is the fuel for holiness, and we face this everyday battle for holiness, then the third point is therefore the motivation for holiness. So the fuel, this hope, it's that emotional drive or that passion that we have, that, oh, I see the salvation, and so it initiates this desire in me. But then the battle hits. The battle hits, and I feel discouraged. So then what do I do? What is my motivation? What do I look at? There's many reasons for us to be holy in our thoughts and actions. Peter quotes Leviticus 11:44, where he says, where God says, be holy, for I am holy. Peter seems to think that's reason enough, and it kind of is. But God calls us to a level of holiness that's rooted in His own character. As He is holy, we are to be holy. I can't do that. None of us can do that. So maybe not be discouraged, because we're going to talk about that. May we not be discouraged, because God is passionate and His grace is sufficient and it's abundant. We stumble and we fall because we are imperfect and fallen creatures. But we should not let that discourage us from seeking the Lord so that we grow in holiness. Let those failures propel us into His presence, seeking that grace. Our inadequacy should not eliminate the desire, but compel us to seek the presence of God in humble surrender. One commentary that I've been using in my study throughout 1 Peter, he points out three motivations for holiness from the following verses, 16 through 19. He says God's holy character, God's impartial judgment, and Christ's precious sacrifice. While I won't delve into each verse, I'll just sum up each of those points. So, part of our motivation, God's holy character. As a Christian, we are filled with God's Spirit. We're filled with God Himself. Therefore, this holy God lives inside of us and gives us the capability and desire to live a holy life. We are motivated, he says, we are motivated in holiness by the desire and opportunity to reflect God's character. He implants that desire inside of us because He is within us. The second piece of motivation, God's impartial judgment. Do not, this is what I wrote here, be not haughty in your role as a Christian or American or gender or class or race or whatever. There is no reason for us to lift our noses in the air just because we've been cleansed by the blood of Jesus. That's His very vicious warning here in verse 17. God judges impartially, he says, without bias. It does not matter who you are or where you come from, each of us is judged by our actions. This haughty mindset is what Paul warns against in Romans chapter 6, verse 1, where he asks the rhetorical question, are we to sin so that grace may abound? He says, absolutely not. That is not the mentality we should have. Oh, I'm set free, so I can do whatever I want. No, we fight against our mindset. We fight against the sin in our lives. Again, to quote the commentary, he says, thus, instead of presumptuous sin, which is always the result of taking His grace for granted, Peter motivates us to live out our days in fear because of His impending and impartial judgment. So God's holy character, God's impartial judgment, and thirdly, Christ's precious sacrifice. Christ's precious sacrifice. The third blow of Peter's admonition to holiness is to look at the cross of Christ. Like a lamb without blemish being offered as an atonement for sin, Christ, perfect Christ, sacrificed and suffered for our freedom. He suffered and was sacrificed.